All right, now, our next speaker is Ryan Bell. He's a national organizing manager at the Secular Student Alliance. Now, after nearly 20 years in congregational pastoral ministry, yes, we get lots of ex-ministers in this movement, he left his church in 2013 and shortly thereafter began an exploration of atheism and humanism at the Year Without God blog. And since leaving his faith behind, Ryan has been a writer and a speaker on the subjects of religion, humanism, and justice. In 2015, he launched a project called Life After God and the Life After God podcast. His recent writing can be found at The Humanist, CNN, and The Guardian. And so let us welcome Ryan Bell.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here with you. 3 weeks ago, I had the opportunity to represent the humanist community in Los Angeles at the third annual Interfaith Solidarity March in Los Angeles. I don't know if Ian Dodd is here at the moment. Yes, Ian was with me. We had people from CFI Los Angeles, others from Sunday Assembly, some Unitarian Universalist members who have spent time with us at Sunday Assembly and so forth. And it was a great time. We had the opportunity to stand in solidarity with others in the interfaith community in Los Angeles who care about the issues of peace and justice. I marched alongside of all of these folks, everything from the Abrahamic faiths, Hindus, Buddhists, Sikhs, Scientologists, and even some cops. The last two caused me a little trouble, to be honest. Apparently the police are now a faith in Los Angeles. But you know, these are people that I've worked with for the last 5 years, or that I haven't worked with for the last 5 years, but have worked with for the prior 8 or 9 years when I was a minister in Los Angeles. And it was a really remarkable homecoming for me in a way to be around some of the folks that I used to work with in the progressive religious movement. And I think they're slowly finding a way to include humanism again in those spaces. So I'd like to share with you just a couple sentences from my comments to them. They allowed me to share at each of the different places we heard comments from different religious leaders. And when it came time for us to be towards the end of it, we were at the Islamic Center of Southern California, actually, where I was able to make a couple of comments about humanism. And this is part of what I shared with them. I said to them, my humanism is a last resort. No one is coming to save us. It's up to us to save ourselves. Religion has been the source of deep consolation and unspeakable suffering and pain. Religions have waged wars and peace, deepened divisions, and created bridges of understanding. And what all those moves for peace and wholeness share in common are people, human beings, reaching beyond mere self-interest, committed to the common good, human beings who understand that we have this one planet and that our common enemy is mistrust and hatred of the other. Humanism is a commitment without promises, without hope of salvation or an afterlife or a utopia in this life, a commitment to care for one another and build a safer world insofar as it's within our power to do so. I also shared with them the opening words of the Humanist Manifesto, the current one, which says that humanism is a progressive philosophy of life that without supernaturalism affirms our ability and responsibility to lead ethical lives of personal fulfillment that aspire to the greater good of humanity. There's a lot packed into that one sentence, and there's a lot more sentences to the manifesto, as you know. But certainly one of the key words in that statement is supernaturalism. And without supernaturalism. It's a philosophical statement. It's a statement of belief, almost, in a way, a hypothesis about the best way to live life and the best way to search for truth without supernaturalism. Stated positively, it's a life lived according to the principles and philosophy of materialism. Now, we're not talking about the kind of materialism that we witness all around us here in Las Vegas. There's quite a bit of that sort of materialism here. You could buy anything and everything without leaving the comfort of the air conditioning. Or the season like Christmas when we tend to talk about commercialism and materialism. Scientific metaphysical materialism says that matter is all that there is, including consciousness and our mental states. All of them arise from the material world, and that what we can know and the work that we need to do arises from our interactions with the material world. That's what we can know. And I think that was what was most comforting to me about my move from a religious worldview to a humanist worldview, which was that it allowed me to deal with the world that I could get my hands on, the world that I could do something about. As my faith began to wane in the latter years of my ministry, I replaced it with the ability to mobilize myself and others towards the common good. And I think that sense of being able to focus on what I knew rather than what I didn't know gave me a lot of strength. And then when I finally left my faith, the focus on humanism really coalesced around, for me, the ability to do good in the areas of life that we can do something about. Most of us are probably generally comfortable with this idea of materialism in this room. At least methodologically, we understand that this is what we have. Like it or not, this is the truth. That we inhabit a reality that is entirely material and can be known by our five senses using the scientific method as far as we understand. It rules out a lot of other nonsense that we can just forget about and focus on the things that we can do something about. And for those of us who grew up religious, what this really means is that nothing and no one is coming to save us. What you see is what you get. And when I talk to people who are in the process of leaving their faith behind or losing their faith, this is the biggest problem for them, the biggest crisis for them, the idea that there is no promise, there is no guarantee that this all ends well. As Anthony Pinn said so beautifully yesterday, Martin Luther King Jr. said, "The arc of the universe is long and bends towards justice." And the best we can do is to say, the arc of the universe is long. And so this idea of materialism, I would say this metaphysical materialism, I would call a good start. But where do we go from here? And this is what's occupied my mind and my thoughts for the last several years. I was a pastor for nearly 20 years, but since 9/11 in particular, I saw firsthand what philosophers and humanists have been saying for decades in various different ways. That a supernatural worldview anesthetizes a person to the actual lived realities faced by ordinary people. By promising something better in the by and by, a world beyond this one where all wrongs will be put to rights, I disempowered most of my congregants from making a tangible, real-world difference in their own lives and in the lives of others. If Jesus is going to come one day and fix it all, then we can just sit back and sort of relax until that day comes. And I'd like to suggest that there is a continuity today between metaphysical or scientific materialism and what we talk about as historical materialism. And I think this, for me at least, is the next step, and I want to offer it to you for your consideration. I would say that our understanding as humanists thus far is that our understanding of materialism is too shallow. We need a humanist materialism that goes all the way down. Not just confined to metaphysical concerns, bourgeois, middle-class concerns, but to take the next step towards historical materialism, to step out of our comfort and ask ourselves, if no one is coming to save us, and if humanism is about maximal human thriving, then what must we do to get serious about movements of human liberation, and beyond that, to the whole natural world, as we heard in our previous presentation? Why do we need to focus beyond metaphysical materialism? Why do we need to move to the next step, which is, in my view, historical materialism? Why is it not enough to simply leave each other alone in a sort of libertarian idealism? The answer for me is that the wretched of the earth, as Franz Fanon called them, cry out for a humanism that goes deeper, which is more creative, that addresses the real concerns of real people, that calls me to step out of my white middle class cishet male bubble of protection and into the world where others are suffering, to hear the testimony of the majority of the world struggling under the yoke of oppression. For me, this has meant developing a robust class consciousness, understanding the suffering caused by capitalism and colonialism, and working alongside my comrades in movements of liberation. So I want to give you a few examples of what these movements of liberation are, and you know as well as I do what they are, but it wouldn't be a good presentation if I didn't illustrate what I was talking about. So the first one that may come to your mind is the movement for Black Lives. Sikibu Hutchinson has said over and over again in a variety of different ways, but again and again and again until folks will listen, that progressive, atheist, humanist, and secular organizations need to proactively and visibly mobilize around issues that go far beyond the usual church-state separation and science and reason agenda. Now notice that she says not just that we need to talk about these issues, which I think we're doing pretty well these days. We are talking about things. But she says that we need to organize, that we need to proactively and visibly mobilize around these issues. For every attorney working on religious liberty causes, we should have an attorney working on civil rights, defending the defenders of black and brown bodies that are flagrantly disregarded, beaten, tossed aside, and killed in our society. And for those of us who are white and middle class, to learn how to be accomplices to those that are fighting this fight for their communities, for the movement for black lives. Just today, the movement for black lives announced that they are standing in solidarity with Palestinians, and that's the next example that I want to share with you. You probably know that the death toll from the Nakba Day protests held last week has reached 64 people. Two people died of their injuries just today. And another 1,300 were injured when the Israeli Defense Force fired live rounds into the crowd of protesters, which included children and many of the elderly. This is almost literally shooting fish in a barrel. And the UN Human Rights Chief, along with other humanitarian organizations, have issued harsh rebukes and called for an investigation into a disproportional use of force. And of course, that's just the beginning of what needs to happen, right? How many rebukes have already been issued? How many investigations have been conducted into these crimes in the past? And yet here we are, with no justice for the Palestinians who were forcibly removed from their land 70 years ago. 70 years of broken promises and severe human rights abuses and death. And so the Movement for Black Lives has just recently said that they're standing in solidarity with the Free Palestine Movement. And those protesters in the Gaza Strip are not giving up. And then, that sort of brings me to a cluster of issues that I would categorize under the crisis of capitalism. And I'll just give you a couple of examples of what the crisis of capitalism looks like. And again, you don't need me to tell you this. You know what it looks like. Los Angeles has been working on very specific solutions to homelessness for many years, at least the past 13 years that I've lived there. Many of those efforts I was instrumental in promoting, advocating for, implementing as I worked in homeless services. And I saw firsthand the revolving door of market-based solutions to homelessness. And what is the result? Well, just a month ago, the Los Angeles Times reported that the homelessness population has grown by 76% in the past 6 years. We've put millions and millions and millions of dollars into housing the homeless and ending the crisis of homelessness in Los Angeles, and the crisis has grown by 76%. How many people do you think live homeless in Los Angeles County? 40,000? Do I hear 50? 50,000? Any higher? 58,000 people in Los Angeles County. That's the size of a decent-sized city. Live on the streets, in parks, and in their cars and RVs in Los Angeles. Meanwhile, just to the north, the Golden City of Seattle is a similar story. While Amazon is searching for its second headquarters and promising an economic revolution to whichever city it chooses, what they don't want you to know is that Seattle has the third largest homeless population in the United States. Now, it's one thing to be homeless in Los Angeles. Imagine being homeless in Seattle, where they get, 100 days of sun a year? And that homeless population has increased 44% in the last 2 years. Home to the richest man in the world, Jeff Bezos, worth $130 billion. Amazon has been on the rise, and so has the number of people living on the street. Then there's the climate crisis, which we heard a little bit about in the last presentation and so beautifully from David Suzuki last night. And I just briefly, I'm not an expert in climate science or solutions to the climate crisis that we're facing, but I do know that the solutions are not to be found in capitalism. Capitalism is the problem, not the solution. The reason we Americans are not taking action and leading the world in preserving our environment is not because we don't know what to do, like if we knew more, we'd change, or if we just had another public information campaign that would convince people that the climate scientists are right and the 2% of scientists that disagree are wrong. The problem is not knowledge, the problem is not information, the problem is a commitment to a system that's destroying us. The climate change denialists aren't dealing with an ignorance problem, they're dealing with a crisis of values, the same as every other crisis that we've faced. Chattel slavery in this country was nearly impossible to root out, not because people lacked knowledge or compassion, but because they lacked the courage of their convictions to prioritize people over their economic interests. It would have destroyed the economy, they said. And we could talk about the prison industrial complex, which exists at the intersection of systemic racism, violent policing, and capitalism, as more and more of our prisons are being sold to private enterprise. Imagine the value of your stock or the value of your company depending on how many beds you filled in a prison. Karl Marx claimed that what propels history forward is the dynamic relationship between people and their economic relations. That when tension between classes reaches a tipping point, change happens. And in the past few hundred years, we've seen our society move from a slave economy to a feudal economy to capitalism. And we don't have time to talk about all the ways that slave economy, feudalism, and capitalism are similar while also being different. But Marx believed that capitalism would eventually collapse under its own weight, and we would enter a socialist era whereby workers own the means of production and are liberated from the capitalist oppressor who grows fat off the surplus value of his workers' labor. My claim today is that humanism should be a broad-based movement for liberation. Inasmuch as many of us have found liberation from oppressive philosophies, faulty thinking, and abusive religious institutions through humanism, these same liberatory principles should move beyond parochial middle-class concerns about metaphysics. We should embrace the continuity between metaphysical materialism and historical materialism, which says that the specific economic and productive relations between people is the locus of people's struggle for freedom. Ideas matter, but people's physical, material well-being matter more. And that what moves the needle in change is not a new idea that then trickles down and changes people's behavior, but crisis between classes that bubbles up and changes people's attitudes about the way the world works. We're not going to think our way out of the climate crisis. We're not going to suddenly wake up and decide one day that the prison industrial complex is immoral. We already know that it's immoral. The humanism I am longing for, and that many people are literally dying for, is a humanism that goes all the way down, that sees in the core principles of human agency and control over our own destiny the seeds for a bold, unapologetic, anti-colonial, anti-racist, anti-sexist, and anti-capitalist efforts, which are at bottom all movements for human liberation. And the last thing I want to mention before I close is something that I've heard a lot since I've been here, which is, how do we get more young people involved in humanist movements around the country? How do we get more young adults, college-age kids, graduates, involved in your local humanist chapters? Nothing would make me more excited. When I was a pastor, I had a lot of young adults in my church, and people always asked me why that was true. And the answer was always the same, that there were young adults at my church because my focus wasn't on getting young adults to my church. Like, they didn't want to come and sit in my pews. That wasn't their goal. If the goal of getting young adults to the meeting is to have young adults come to the meeting, young adults probably aren't going to come to the meeting, right? They want to be part of something bigger than themselves. They want to be part of something beyond the group, for which the group is a vital support, but not the end in itself. At SSA, we like to call ourselves the leading edge of the secular humanist movement. That's a little bold. Yeah, maybe a little arrogant, I don't know. But I think it's true, because what we're dealing with are the young adults, the youth coming up right now, and they're telling us what matters to them. They're telling us what is on their minds, what their humanism means, what their secularism means. And yes, it does mean separation of church and state. It does mean pushing back, especially in this current White House, against encroachments of religion in our public life. But it's not limited to that. We have student chapters that are joining DACA protests at their campuses as students are being threatened with deportation. We have groups that are involved in climate change struggles. We have groups that are involved in Black Lives Matter movements and movements for liberation of people of color. They see that humanism entails a mandate to struggle for our social and economic liberation. And they engage in a much deeper analysis than I was ever taught as a young person growing up. If I knew how to conduct an economic analysis and the way that these young adults do today of our social world, I would be so far ahead of where I am today. I'm catching up to where they are. So I would just close by saying I can't guarantee this, of course, but I think that if our groups, our chapters, our organizations would engage in movements of liberation, movements of human liberation, that we would see our young people join that cause with vigor. Thank you.
All right. The first three people who line up at this mic get to ask questions. And we have our three. Or no. Well, we do. Okay. Go for it. Ask.
When you speak of materialism or historical materialism, where does emotional intelligence, compassion, love, and empathy, and those things that are not understood as material, but emotional component of how we approach ethical issues and come pretty much uniformly to the same position on issues like LGBT rights and abortion rights and all these other positions that we take, we're, you know, uniformly on the same page by discarding supernatural as the basis for our values.
I was convinced, I haven't read this book. Could someone know the book that was recently written about empathy as a negative? Paul, somebody? Anyway, his point, I think, is that if we rely on empathy to guide our ethics, we'll care about the things that move us, and we won't care about the things that don't move us. And I think in as much as our empathy is engaged, I think that's a great thing. I don't think what he means is that it's bad to feel empathetic, but that we cannot rely solely on our empathy to guide us in our ethics, because there are some things out there that may not, you know, rise to the level of our empathetic concern. I'm not an expert on all of that, but I think that we need that component as well. I don't know how to teach that necessarily, how we help people become more empathetic. I do think that we are fighting in some ways some aspects of human nature, which say, I've got mine and good luck to you. That's a struggle that we have, and I think empathy can help us overcome some of that as well. Yes.
Hi, I'm John Metter with the Ethical Society of Austin, Texas. So on that line, I've asked some other folks this question, and it just occurred to me this weekend. What does humanism have to offer the person that is in the middle of their life and they're actually spiritually broken? Like, they're 35, they're going to get a divorce, they owe $100,000, they got three kids, they hate their job.
I only have two kids.
All right, two kids. No more than two kids. That's the thing. You know, that person, if they were to come to you when you were a minister, you probably just had, you just ate it up. I don't know, does humanism have a response other than, well, what do you think about climate change? I mean, that does nothing to a person.
Sure.
You know, a rational response to a person who is, I'm just going to say, spiritually broken. I'm just going to use that as a metaphor.
Sure.
What does humanism have to say to that person, and how do we get them in?
Yeah, it's really difficult. I just had a student. She's not middle-aged. She's a USC student. And she's just grappling right now with the serious doubts about her faith. Her family's very religious. And for a 21-year-old, she's got a pretty, like, front-and-center fear of dying. And I wasn't worried about dying when I was 21. But she's a sharp kid, and she's, you know, tuned in to some things. And I was a little bit embarrassed by how I stammered around a little bit, because I basically wanted to say to her, yeah, I mean, when you die, you know, that's it, you know, and she knows that. I think she feels that already. She didn't need me to tell her that. But I think what I did tell her was that and what I had to do was turn my sights closer to home, you know, like take my view from this horizon of like the great by and by, which will, you know, if my life sucks now, at least it won't suck later, and then focus more on what I have right here, right now. So we talked about her family a little bit. We talked about her parents, her siblings, and she said they were enormously supportive. She was graduating the very next day from USC, and I'm like, well, that's something to be happy about. She has a bright, bright future ahead of her. So I tried to help her focus more near term on the things that were really good about her life. And for me, that ended up turning the corner for me. But I don't, we certainly don't have a wonderful solution for like a long term.
God's got a plan for your life.
Yeah, no, there's not. And I think part of growing up is grappling with that reality. Yeah. One more, or are we done? One more.
Hi, I'm Liz Renda with the Pittsburgh Freethought Community.
Hi, Liz.
What you're talking about doing, that social activism and organizing, is terrifically hard. And the reward is really in the relationships, not in the outcome. Mm-hmm. I think about Black Lives Matter, you know, what a great movement that is, how well it is led, and yet, you know, still battling upstream. For those of us in humanist local organizations, we're just kind of dipping our toes into that kind of stuff.
Right.
Mm-hmm. How do we maintain ourselves and each other if we get wholly involved in that kind of work? Because it's hard.
It's hard. Yeah, and I think, you know, I forget who said this, a famous civil rights organizer, that every battle worth winning is worth losing about 100 times. And really, any social movement that wins has lost that battle over and over and over until they finally win. And it is a difficult struggle. My experience in the church was that the more we got engaged in social action, movements for justice in our community, the more it drove us together as a community. Because we were like, you know, beat up out there, you know, working on this seemingly losing cause. The more we got battered by that reality, the more we needed to pull together and say, all right, let's debrief, let's talk about what we learned, that was a painful loss, what happened, what can we do better? So the group gathering becomes not only about strategizing, but about sort of licking our wounds and supporting one another and finding that, for lack of a better expression, spiritual support, emotional, probably a better word, support for one another. And again, I didn't have time to get into this, but I think you're right that relationships are the primary outcome. And believe me, I'm not trying to say that 10, you know, middle-class people from the suburbs are going to fix Black Lives Matter or anything like that. I think what matters is that solidarity and that standing with and being alongside and learning how to be an accomplice, because there are roles for allies and accomplices that are not, you know, in the front of those movements, but that mean a great deal if we learn how to do it well. And I think being there, just showing up. I mean, I can't tell you as an organizer how much it meant for me to have people just merely show up. If there's a protest, if there's a thing at City Hall or whatever it is, another body in the room means everything. And so it doesn't have to be, you know, complicated, but just to be there and then to gather back with your group, Pittsburgh Freethought, and say, all right, that was tough. What did we learn? What book are we reading? What article can we read that will help us understand this better and just move forward in that way?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ryan. Thank you.